How's it going, my truant people? Dr.Slaking, the Slacking Doctor, back for week 5, I believe, of the APA Academy. And this week, your Bowland Bovines are going up against Tony or Shady. He goes by both, so I'm not sure which one he prefers to be known by on YouTube. But anyway, Tony slash Shady and his Buffalo Drills, I'm pretty sure is correct. With the nice excadrille mascot there. And I should quickly say this, hopefully you can't hear it, but in the background behind me, there is a huge fan going because it is really hot today and my room is essentially like an attic room. So it gets incredibly hot in my room. So yeah, if you can hear like a little bit of background noise, I'm hoping it's not too severe. But for the next few weeks, that might be going on just while it's really hot here. It's England, it won't stay hot for long, don't worry. And then we'll be back to having no background noise. But yeah, I might try and get a smaller fan or something, because my fan at the minute is absolutely massive, but it's really keeping me cool, so that's something. We don't live in a hot enough country to have aircon or anything like that, so we just have to set up a fan manually when it comes around, when we have our one hot day a year. Regardless, like always, above my head will be a timestamp if you guys want to click ahead to the battle and just watch that. If you want to stick around to Team Builder, I'm going to go through that right now. Unfortunately, the way the APA doc is being run at the minute has changed slightly since the first draft, so I can't put that nice little graphic that I had of my opponent's team with all the sprites on it, but I will find some way of putting up my opponent's team. I think on that side, I don't know, on one side of me right now, my opponent's team will appear, and I've got something in my eye. Presumably the fan has just blown dust or something into my eye and it's killing me already. God damn it, I didn't think about that. Regardless, you can see my opponent's team. My opponent has Mega Gallade, Salamence, Mamoswine, Reuniclus, Vaporeon, Aromatisse, Alolan Muk, Rotom Moe, Ambipom, Magmortar, and Klefki, and it's open sea, so we've got to worry about that. Major threats to my team, Mega Gallade once again. I should say as well, this is our first week with our new draft. If you haven't checked out our draft analysis for our second draft, go and check that out, because this is a really, really fun draft. A bit of a mess, but fuck it, we'll see what happens. Yeah, facing Mega Gallade 2 out of 3 weeks is pretty scary, having faced it against Silver the other week, so not looking forward to that. Once again, we don't have the best matchup against it. Salamence is a really, really scary threat. Mamoswine can potentially be a problem, although we do have one of the best checks in the game to it, which I'll get onto, sort of. Then there's other things like Vaporeon, Reuniclus that are kind of hard to break. Alolan Muk can be a setup threat. Magmortar and Ambipom still hit decently hard, and Klefki is just obnoxious. So that's kind of the rundown of my opponent's team. First set that we are bringing, first mon that we are bringing on this team is going to be Baton, our Blaziken with the Fiery MZ this week, rocking the Flare Blitz, High Jump Kick, Stone Edge, Swords Dance. This is just like max attack, max speed. Should speed tie with like Mamoswine and stuff at the very least. Basically, he's just a phenomenal breaker against his team for some of our cleaners in the late game, particularly being able to SD and then hit everything on his team that can really switch into me, whether it's a Fire MZ into Reuniclus, whether it's a Stone Edge into an Intimidate Salamence, whether it's a High Jump Kick into a Vaporeon. We can hit everything decently hard on his team. There's nothing that can really wall this Blaziken. So yeah, pretty happy about that. And if he does go hard Salamence with the Intimidate and stuff, that would be more scary because he does outspeed us potentially, but I see that being less likely as a switch into something like Reuniclus or Vaporeon, which I think we can nuke a bit easier. The Fiery MZ on there obviously just lets us bop like one thing really, really well without having to risk the High Jump Kick, recoil, and miss and stuff. Second set on the team, Adam Sandler making the debut on the channel. I should say as well, I have used Blaziken before in a lower tier format, so I'm kind of experienced with Blaziken to some extent. But this is my first time using Crobat properly outside of Mox stuff, and I'm really excited to be using Adam Sandler. Brave Bird, Taunt, Roost, U-Turn. Basically a support set with a little bit of attack investment, a lot of bulk, a lot of speed, just so that we can kind of revenge kill the Mega Gallade very, very easily. We can switch in on something like a Drain Punch or a Close Combat relatively easily. We can taunt things like the Reuniclus that otherwise might want to set up on us, as well as things like Klefki's to stop it, say, getting up 2 screens or getting up 2 laser spikes or whatever it is that Klefki wants to do. Taunt can be pretty useful too. Roost means that we can wall most things on the team as well. So really, really cool. Really, really cool Crobat set here, and I think should do some good work. Then next up, we have Gene, the Gardevoir. Choice Scarf set this week with the Trace ability, being able to trace anything on his team that has immunities to itself. I don't really think he has too much, but the Intimidate on Salamence is really, really useful. Regen potential on Reuniclus is really, really nice as well. Water Absorb from Vaporeon could be pretty useful. But for the most part, really, yeah, there's not too much that we would want to trace that well. Prankster could be useful if you look at that bottom move there with Healing Wish. If we get Prankster off Klefki, being able to Prankster Healing Wish could be pretty nice too. So, you know, we have some interesting abilities we can trace here, but the main one is the Intimidate from the Salamence. Being able to come in and Intimidate down a +1 Salamence is really, really nice if he's a Dragon Dance set. We have enough speed on this to outspeed something like Scarf, Magmorta maybe? I don't even know if it's that. I don't know. Scarf something anyway. We've got quite a bit of speed on this. With the Psychic, the Moonblast, and the Shadow Ball, we can hit his whole team for decent damage with that coverage. The Klefki looks like the most likely switch into the Psychic and the Moonblast and the Shadow Ball. We'll chunk that down a little bit with this having a modest nature on this actually and max special attack. So pretty nice. We've got quite a bit of bulk in this as well. So really nice set there. Next up, we have Red. Red returning from the IBL D League. If you watched our season there, we traded for this mon halfway through the season, and Scissor was amazing for us. Once again, we're bringing a Banded set. I do feel like, in many ways, this is the best Scissor set. Sword Stance is also very good. Supportive sets can be very useful. But Choice Band is the easiest set just to slap on and see what happens, really. It's a bit like Delmanitan with Scarf or something. Like, you just throw it on there and see what happens. But in this matchup, I do think it has a pretty good matchup because Banded U-Turn, if we can get it in against, like, the Reuniclus, for example, it kind of has to switch out, and then we can Banded U-Turn and get some nice damage off on something, maybe off on the Salamence coming in, then we get into Gene and we get to fire off Moonblast. So it's kind of like a nice little pivot in this team too, but crucially with that Pursuit, we can actually Pursuit Trap the Reuniclus and kind of nullify that, which means one of his best checks to Buzzwole, our Blaziken, is already being taken down, which forces in things like the Vaporeon against us and the Salamence against us instead. So that's the kind of idea here, is that if we want to make a double early in the game with Blaziken into our Scissor and we can try and Pursuit Trap the Reuniclus, then we can really go in with Blaziken in the later game. Why do we want to go with Blaziken so much? Well, because of the fifth mon on our team, and that is Choice Scarf Mien Shao Brittany. Having double fighting type is kind of interesting. This is the first time I've ever got to use it. And I feel like it works pretty well in terms of Blaziken can blow a hole that then Brittany can clean through. So that's the kind of idea. So we can trap the Reuniclus, and then we can maybe break through the Vaporeon with Blaziken or the Salamence with Blaziken. Suddenly the high jump kick switches on my opponent's team are few and far between. With the Scarf on here, we can outspeed a plus one Salamence and KO it with a Rock Slide as long as we get some chip off on it. U-Turn is also pretty nice just to keep up momentum, Poison Jab on there to hit the Aromatisse, which could come, but I don't think it has great matchup. And last but not least, our sixth one on the team is Infinite. Kieran Black, a Life Orb set this week. This set is really, really cool. It's kind of an emergency check to Reuniclus. So as you can see, we have the Sub and the Endeavor, and the reason being that, like I say, if Reuniclus wants to try and set up being like a Acid Armor whatever set, we can kind of keep subbing down and then eventually Endeavor him and put him in range of like Bullet Punch from Scissor or something. Most of the things on our team out of speed anyway, so we probably won't have to rely on priority. The only reason I think we might have to do that is if he's like a Trick Room set, for example. But yeah, basically we can keep subbing down until we're down to 1 HP, and then we can Endeavor him to match. We will go down to our Life Orb Recoil and get him on in for free to then punish him. So that's pretty cool. If he chooses to recover on that turn, that's a pretty nice read. I don't think he will. This works pretty well in my mocks. It's also just useful because Life Orb, Dragon Claw plus Iron Head hits his whole team. So it's also just a good breaker against this team, which is pretty nice too. So yeah, that's the build. That's the kind of general thinking here. Without wasting too much more of your time, let's jump into the battle and see how it all went. So here we are in the battle, guys, and I forgot to do a couple of shoutouts at the beginning of the video. I knew there was something I forgot. So just very quickly, shout out to, I believe, MidPokeMaster for recording this battle for me. And shout out to DyeItTight for genning the team for me. That man has been an absolute hero lately, genning pretty much all my teams. So shout out to both of those two. And shout out to my front office for helping me prep, particularly. I believe Aquarius and Stromful gave me mocks for this one, I think. If other people did too, then shout out to them. Like, it was a little while ago, so I can't quite remember. But yeah, shout out to all those people. I'm so sorry for forgetting. I'm just it's a hot day. My brain's frazzled. What can I say? But here we are in the battle anyway, guys. Hopefully that fan behind me again, like I said earlier, hopefully it's not too noisy. Let me know in the comment section if it's just too loud, and I'll try and figure something else out for future videos. But hopefully it's not too bad. So looking at team preview here. He does bring the Salamence, the Reuniclus, and the Vaporeon, as well as the Klefki, I suppose. But these three are his major checks to like a high jump kick sweep in the end game. In terms of Vaporeon could have Protect and also could maybe just take one and then potentially burn us. Reuniclus will definitely take a high jump kick. Salamence will definitely take a high jump kick. And Klefki can paralyze us. So it's not ideal. Galadriel needs to get some chip on, but I'm fairly confident of being able to do that. So instead I'm looking at Gardevoir and I'm like, okay, Gardevoir actually looks kind of better in the end game because other than the Klefki, which I'm going to have to deal with one way or another, like one of my end game win cons is going to end up paralyzed. There's nothing I can do about that really because I'm going to have to get something paralyzed to deal with Klefki. But other than that, actually, Gardevoir looks really, really great with like Shadow Ball being unresisted against his team. Looks really, really awesome too. So hopefully we can figure something out like that. And Crobat being able to outspeed his whole team outside of Scarfers is really nice too. And it does actually hit most things pretty well, being able to taunt the Klefki, being able to taunt the Vaporeon, being able to taunt the Reuniclus, being able to U-turn on the Reuniclus and stuff like that, being able to Brave Bird into the other mons. Like it looks decent in this matchup actually, being able to taunt a potential setup Salamence. And in particular, I'm going to look to try and break with my Blaziken as early as possible. So with that in mind, because this team is built around trying to break with Blaziken, I'm just going to lead off with it. I'm just going to start off with Blaziken turn one. It leads well against his only hazard setter, which he's brought, which is the Klefki. And it is the mon that if I have to get a mon paralyzed, I would rather be the Blaziken than anything else, as it isn't scarfed, and it has no way to boost its speed anyway, and it naturally underspeeds everything on his team that is significant. Because after paralysis, it will still outspeed things like the Reuniclus, for example. So here I consider just going for the SD. I will take a Scald because Blaziken is okay. It's not like super tanky, but from defensive ones, it will take a hit. I thought about just going raw for the SD, but it didn't seem worth it. I could just go into Gene here, get the Water Resolve, and that way, even if he Scalds, it's no skin off my nose. If he goes for a Wish to Scout, again, no skin off my nose. It's fine. We can pivot around. We can play some games. But he actually goes for the Protect there, which is really, really great information because it means he is scouting for the High Jump Kick. Obviously, me having Mien Shao and Blaziken, I expect to see that a lot. A lot of people running Protect against me, which makes sense. Obviously, we've seen it in the first draft with Mien Shao, a lot of people running Protect. So here we just fire off the Moonblast and we do a good chunk to this Reuniclus, putting it really, really low. Well, not really, really low, but decently low, about 60%, 70%. Did more damage than I expected, so I was pretty happy with that. Here, I'm expecting a Shadow Ball, and I've EV'd Red to take it pretty easily, and here I can just Pursuit Trap this thing, and hopefully we can then just take one of the mons out of the game. So he does go to switch out. We do Pursuit Trap, and this was what the tech was brought for. I know we spoke about it after the game. He thought it was pretty cool tech, but unfortunately, we don't quite pick up the KO. Now, I don't know if this was Magic Guard or Regenerator at this point in the match, so I'm just like, okay, that thing could be about 40% maybe if it's Regenerator. If not, it's down at like 5 to 10%. So that's amazing. He basically is Reunion Close is dealt with, which is exactly what we wanted to do because that's one less High Jump Kick switching for my two fighting types that can abuse that. Here, we're going to pivot out into Gene on the Salamence. I thought he would maybe go for like a Fire Blast or a Fire Fang, and we would take it okay with the Intimidate. Wouldn't do too much at all. I didn't expect him to drag move into Scissor, but he actually just raw goes for the Iron Tail, which is a great read on my opponent's part. Yeah, it was a fairly Telegraph switch in, but this reveals that he's very offensive. Like, in my mocks, Salamences weren't doing that much to me, so I was like, god damn. Unfortunately, this does put us in Shadow Sneak range of the Mega Gallade, so now I'm looking at Gardevoir not as an endgame win con, but rather as a revenge killer, and potential sack if we need to, potential breaker if we can use it that way. But with the Reuniclus so low, his Moonblast switch-ins are not great. We can either get Chip on the Magmortar or the Klefki, and I want Chip on both of those. So I'm perfectly happy just to fire off a Moonblast there. I don't need to read and go for Shadow Ball or anything like that. I can just Moonblast and it's fine. Unfortunately, I don't switch into this Magmortar very well at all because this is such an offensive build that we've got here. So I'm just going to have to go into Kyurem on the Fire Blast. We're going to take a hell of a lot. But with the Reuniclus so low, Kyurem isn't like that emergency backup for Reuniclus. It doesn't need to do anything. It just needs to come in, get off one big hit, claim a kill. As the Reuniclus comes back out, revealing it was in fact a Regenerator, coming back out at about 40%, as I said, but it's going to just drop to that Dragon Claw, so that's really, really nice. Unfortunately, between the Fire Blast damage and the Life Orb recoil, we now can't get a sub. Why is that unfortunate, you might wonder? Because if he goes into this here and then headbutts and misses, it'd be great to be able to get a sub and Endeavor and down to 1 HP, but we are 1 HP too low to set up a substitute, which sucks. As he does go into the Gallade, and I was like, he might just Drain Punch, but then Drain Punch is pretty risky because it does let in the Crobat, so he might not want to do that, and he does actually just go for the Zen Headbutt, which is a perfectly reasonable play. Like I say, it doesn't let me switch into Crobat. It's just, had he missed there, it would have been great to be able to Endeavor him down, but obviously that wasn't the case. We can go into Adam Sandler regardless. And here I'm just going to click the U-turn because I don't think he ever gives me this thing to a Brave Bird. Like, there's just no reason when he has a Klefki in the back. As much as I would like to chip down Klefki so I could have just Brave Birded, what I prefer doing at this stage in the match is getting in Blaziken again on this thing, because then he has a bit of a dilemma where does he T-Wave me and just let me set up, or does he go hard into Vaporeon and try and pressure me? Regardless, I'm clicking SD here. Like, I know I'm U-turning into Baton. I'm clicking SD and I'm just like, you gotta give me one. Like, we're trading right now, or you've got to do some very good pivoting. That's what Blaziken can really do in this matchup. So finally, our breaker hits the field and we're able to SD as he goes into Vaporeon. And now we have a really interesting 50-50 where am I High Jump Kick? Do I SD again on his Protect? Does he even go for the Protect? And I predict him actually to go for the Protect here, but rather than SDing, what I do instead is I just go for the Firium Z. And you might wonder, like, why did I do that? Well, if he tried pivoting it into Salamence to get an Intimidate off, for example, that would have dropped that thing really, really low. If he had tried protecting like he does here, what this does is guarantee to put him in High Jump Kick range the following turn, even if he's max Fizz Def. We don't quite Oko from full always to Vaporeon, but with this little bit of chip, even if he's got lefties with that little bit of recovery, I believe that we should always Oko a Fizz Def Vaporeon with a plus 2 High Jump Kick. So that was kind of my idea there. That's why I just went raw for the Firium Z. Even though, and like I say, if he hadn't protected, then we would have put him down, like, probably down to about 50% or something. We could have played around that. Here I am just going to High Jump Kick because he's now guaranteed in range, as I said. And if he went into Salamence or something, he's probably still going to take 50%-ish, I don't know, from a plus 1 High Jump Kick, and then we'll deal with that as we deal with that. So he goes into Gallade. Of course, this thing is technically a High Jump Kick resist, but unless he was like a Fizz Step Wish set, it wasn't that likely. Drain Punch isn't that great against my team because I have things like Gardevoir and Crobat. that make Drain Punch pretty unreliable. So I'm actually going to pivot out to Scissor here. He's showing me that he always wants to Zen Headbutt, and I believe he's going to do it again, so I may as well get Scissor in while I can on that. I think he just doesn't want to let my Crobat in, and I completely agree with that. Here we can fire off the BP with Red, and just get as much damage as we can, because I think he'll probably either Close Combat or Drain Punch, or as he reveals here, Fire Punch this turn and KO me. Any of the above worked for him, so basically just getting off that Bullet Punch chip was my absolute best play. Basically putting him right down in range so that he can't take a high jump kick from the end shower, which is of course our end game win con with Gardevoir being so low, being in Shadow Sneak range. We can't win the game with Gardevoir anymore, which sucks. So we're really trying to position everything to the point where we can just kind of win with the end shower. Here I go for the Brave Bird because I did U-turn last time and I don't want to be too telegraphed, and because I do feel like we're currently in the lead, I feel like he might try and make some ballsy plays to swing it back in his favor. And letting the Klefki come in and take a little bit more chip actually works for me perfectly fine. And as I say, I can just go into Blaziken, and if he chooses to T-Wave, because I cannot stay in with Crobat there, because Crobat cannot be T-Waved, as that's so important to hit the Gallade all the time. Really, really important to keep Crobat at full speed. So, especially as I say with Shadow Sneak on the potential on the Gallade. So I don't mind getting Basun T-Waved here because it doesn't really outspeed anything on his team anymore. Particularly it might outspeed the Magmortar, it might outspeed the Salamence depending on spreads and stuff. But here I am just going to Raw Stone Edge predicting the Salamence to come in. As he reveals to be Charty Berry, so after the Intimidate and the Charty Berry like resistance there, we don't do too much. We do, I don't know, 25%. So I'm going to just pivot out hard into Gene here. It's basically just a sack if he chooses to go for another read again. But I don't know really what he's going to do. And I can get an Intimidate off and get my Mien Shao in for free. And then maybe kind of force a 50-50 where do I high jump kick if he goes into Klefki, or do I rock slide if he stays in with this. But he actually just roll goes for the Dragon Claw, so we managed to pull that off really, really nicely. I did think there was a chance it could be Earthquake, but I wasn't quite sure. So here I'm going to double back into Basun because I feel like his best switch into his to my Gardevoir at this stage in the match was 100% his Klefki, but he actually just used to stay in a Fire Fang. So had I Moonblasted there, we would have been in a great spot. I perhaps played more aggressively than I had to. But as he reveals Fire Fang, Dragon Claw, and now Roost, I started to think, I don't think he has Earthquake. In fact, he went from Dragon Claw last time on me, I don't think he has Earthquake at all. So we're just going to Stone Edge here as he does reveal the Roost, and we actually crit. So that really, really sucks, but it doesn't change too much because I would have done the same thing again this turn that I do this turn, which is high jump kick predicting the Roost. Even without the crit, we would have done enough to potentially force him to Roost again to get back to full. I don't know, I'm not 100% sure on that, but the high jump kick basically there forces him to either attack and KO us or go down basically if he chooses to Roost again, because I'm just going to keep spamming high jump kick. It is worth mentioning we do break through para twice there, I think. So definitely the crit and the breaking through para to some extent is a little bit fortuitous, but like I say, I feel like even without the crit, as long as we landed our attacks, we would have been fine. And I am really just trying to kind of sack the Blaziken at this point, because that will give me back into the Gardevoir where I can kind of force the same situations and pick up KOs. So like I say, it's definitely some luck there for sure, but I feel like we could have played around it regardless. Here comes the Magmortar with the Inferno. Overdrive basically just wants to make sure he KOs everything on my team, doesn't let me switch out or whatever. Maybe didn't have like Earthquake or anything to even hit my Blaziken, didn't want to risk, I guess, a Zen Headbutt miss on the Gallade or something like that potentially as well, not quite sure. But regardless, this is going to give us Brittany here, and he could have Flame Body, so we are risking the Flame Body burn right here, but I don't really have a better option. I could go into Gardevoir and like Psychic, for example. It doesn't guarantee the KO, I don't think, from memory, depending on his spread, and also it just lets this thing in for free, and then that becomes a bit more of a problem. So here I know he's going to T-Wave, but it doesn't really matter. I'm just going to high jump kick, and I'm going to get a few opportunities just to high jump this thing to the face and KO it, and with this thing down, Crobat will just be able to kill the Gallade, so that's really all I need to do at the minute. And unfortunately, we do miss our first high jump kick, but as long as we don't miss this second one, we'll be fine. Unfortunately, we get fully parried as he goes for the Flash Cannon. Again, it doesn't really matter. As long as we don't get fully parried twice in a row or miss the second one, because we do live that Flash Cannon, we'll be fine. And we do get fully parried again. So we missed High Jump Kick into two full parries as Brittany literally doesn't get to do anything to this Klefki, which essentially loses us this game, because I could go into Gardevoir here and Shadow Ball, but he will still get to T-Wave the Crobat the following turn because Gardevoir can't Oko this thing. So I essentially just have to try and take out this Klefki. Now, I did make something of a misplay here because he missed the T-Wave and I didn't taunt. It's a mild misplay because I was never going to be able to KO him before the taunt wore off anyway. So he was always going to T-Wave me at some point, right? And my only endgame at the minute is to basically break this Klefki with my Crobat and then hope he doesn't have Shadow Sneak on guard on Gallade. If he doesn't, we can still win this game. And theoretically, Adam Sandler can 1v1 this Klefki. I don't know what item he has exactly. But I do have Taunt, I do have Roost, I do have Brave Bird that is doing like decent damage. So we're certainly like, it's put us into a losing position because if he has Shadow Sneak on his Gallade, we're just absolutely boned unless he misses his Zen Headbutt. But other than that, we still have outs here. We just gotta hope he doesn't have Shadow Sneak. So we are going to Brave Bird again here, putting this Klefki really, really low, and I'm like, it just all comes down to his set. Like, at this point, it's kind of not down to outplays and plays, it's kind of just down to what your set is and if you land a Zen Headbutt, and that's really it. So we go for the Taunt here. Basically just stop him from any shenanigans. I don't know what he might have, but I don't want him, like, it suddenly crossed my mind that he could have, like, spikes or something, and could try and spike to stop the Gardevoir from being able to come in at all, and I was like, shit, I should probably have taunted him. So that's why we just go for the Taunt there and fire that off, because I just want to make sure the Gardevoir actually can come in, because, like I say, I'm just gambling on him not having Shadow Sneak. That's my end game right now. We're going to Brave Bird again here, putting him really, really low with a crit, and I'm like, that's perfect. We might actually kill him the next turn. He's got an Aguave berry, he's got a 50% berry, a super berry, and now I'm kind of screwed because he is back at a really good range of health. He's doing a lot of chip to me, and I'm like, okay, my play might be to PP stall him. And at this point, I genuinely, sounds awful, but I consider time stalling. I was like, I might have to just time stall here. Like, his Gallade is pretty low. Maybe I can just put his keys down really low. But we still had like a lot of match time left because we'd both been playing pretty quickly and pretty offensively up until this point. So I was really in a tough choice here. I started slowing down the turns. I started thinking a lot longer. Like, is there anything I can do that isn't time stall? But even with the powers and stuff, like, it's not going to be easy to time stall him to guarantee I have a lot of health, because my Gardevoir has so little health, right, that it's going to be very difficult. I don't actually know who will have more HP at the end of the battle. And this is the turn that he reveals the recycle. And that's when I'm like, yeah, there's nothing I can do. Like, with Prankster, I can't get a fast taunt off on him, so I can't stop him from recycling forever. I can't, like, get him low enough where I know reliably I can time it to timer stall him. Like, we had too much time on the clock for me to actively plan a timer stall. And I'll be honest, if I thought I could, I maybe would have. I want to get wins. That's how it is. So now I'm like, okay, we basically are just going to have to, like, PP stall him, maybe, if we can do that. But with our recoil essentially chipping us down, as well as his flash cannon damage, we're actually, our roosts are being far more pressured than his flash cannons. So that really, really sucks. Here we're going to start taunting to try and, like, stall out some PP and whatever. And it's just like, it's just this really hard thing where basically I'm not in a great position. But if somehow I can, like, I don't know, if somehow I can, like, KO him at the right time, or crucially, what I'm also considering doing at this point is basically getting on him on a turn where I can get in, like, Gardevoir, and he goes for a T-Wave or something like that. If he starts, like, trying to, like, preserve his PP, I can maybe get Gardevoir in for free on a turn and, like, try and Shadow Ball and hope that I outspeed the Gallade through Para, which I don't think I can. I don't know. Like, I'm just going through my head with, like, all these different situations. Or maybe I can get him, like, really low. So basically, this turn is really key. I was trying to time it more than anything so that I could get a Brave Bird into a taunt just before he could, like, get his berry. And then maybe I could, like, do something with it. I don't know. Or, like, sack myself to recoil after a taunt. So if I can kill myself to recoil after a taunt where he is not quite procced his berry, but has got into range of Gardevoir, then maybe I can win. Like, maybe I can win because he'll be taunted, so he can't T-Wave my Gardevoir. My Crobat will go down, and then I'll be able to kill him with Shadow Ball because I'll outspeed him. Does that make sense? So that's really, like, that's my only end game at this point that I can see, is killing my Crobat the same turn that he remains taunted and falls into Shadow Ball range. Like, this is the balancing act I'm very delicately trying to do at this point. And this was the turn where I thought I had it. I thought this Brave Bird would put him right into range. I would take enough recoil where I could, like, taunt and flash cannon and stuff until he killed me. Basically just keeping him at that range of HP, taunting, flash cannon, whatever. But we get the crit. that actually puts him right back up. And I'm like, this is the worst time to get a crit. Like, I didn't want a crit there. I didn't want the crit. Like, if I could have maybe just, like, keep taunting and keeping him, like, flash cannoning me, you do see that we dropped that flash cannon there. We could have got Gardevoir in as his taunt wears off. You see here, his taunt wears off. So, like, if it had been, like, a turn earlier or whatever, we might have just been able to pull it off, maybe. It was like a very fine balancing act, and I don't know if we ever would have done it, but the crit just absolutely scuppered our chances. Here we go for the Shadow Ball. Obviously, he's at a range of health where he's not going to die to it, even to a crit. So we get the Spidef drop, which is what it is, I guess, and he could just flash cannon to pick up the KO. And we are going to lose this game 2-0. Really, really sucks because... I feel like at the point when Mien Shao came in against this thing, well, we did. We had this game won. At the time when the Mien Shao came in against the Klefki, we basically needed to land one out of three opportunities to land a high jump kick. If we landed one out of those three, we've won the game because we basically would have put him into... we would have KO'd the Klefki for starters, and then the Brave Bird from Crobat always would have revenge killed the incoming Gallade. So it's just one of those things where, like, we had the game basically wrapped up, and unfortunately, it just didn't work out for us. It just didn't go our way. So that's Pokemon. That's the risk of running high jump kicks. Sometimes you miss and you take massive recoil and it bones you, especially when you run reckless, which we were. So it happens. There's nothing much we can do about it. Nothing that Tony could have done about it or Shady could have done about it. Like, he played to his outs. He brought Klefki, which is that's Klefki does what Klefki does, right? So definitely just, it just sucks, but he played his game very, very well too. Like I say, I feel like this season, we are now 2-3, so unfortunately we have a negative record. But against Silver, we lost to a double protect. This week, we lost to a high jump kick miss into a double para. We did get some early fortune with things like the crit on the Stone Edge and stuff like that. So, you know, I won't deny that, but I definitely don't feel like we've got the rub of the green so far this season. And I feel like two of our losses with just a little bit of, like, not even just good luck, but, like, just neutral luck, I feel like we could have won two out of our three losses. Against Steven, we got smashed, but yeah, whatever. Moving into next week, we're going to take on ItzWhateva and his Sacremento, I think, Nidokings. This team will be back, of course, second week with this draft. I really like this draft. I think it's super fun. At the beginning, I thought it was terrible, but now I kind of like it. Let me know what you guys thought of this team, what you thought of this battle, and what you thought of... what was your favorite mod on the team? Mine, for sure, was Blaziken this week, but let me know what your guys' favorite mod on this team is. Regardless, I'm going to start rambling on now. Thank you so much for loafing around with me, and I'll catch you again next time.